first thing you have to do is realise that your market is discretion. They don't have to buy your art. It's got to appeal to them. They've got to want to have it, and it's very competitive. There are lots of people out there trying to do the same stuff. It's really strange looking at your people. Looking up. So it's not easy to be seen, heard above the crowd. You have to be prepared to work very hard. In a minute I'm just going to go through what my typical day is. And you have to be pretty disciplined. I mean, it's very easy if you're working and your studio's at home, it's very easy to get distracted by what's going on around you or in the garden or in the kitchen. So you have to be very disciplined and you have to structure your days, I think. You also have to realise that you're a small business person. That might be go against the grain a bit, but you need to work on your business as well as in your business if you want to be successful. That means you've got to try and market yourself. You've got to seek to market. It won't just come to you. You have to find it. You have to get your work out there. You have to find a niche. You've got to differentiate yourself from all the other people out there that are doing similar things. It means keeping your books in order. It's something that artists may not be so good at. But you've got to do your taxes. You've got to just keep track of everything. You have to find ways to maximise your exposure. It's no good having a wonderful body of work and no one ever sees it. I mean, no one can buy it if they can't see it, find it. Now, much as it might go against the grain, you have to force yourself to be entrepreneurial. Now, I am not this type of person. I'm the type of person who would happily sit in my studio and make stuff from dawn till midnight if I had a rich patron and they were just paying me to do it. That'd be great, but I don't. So I have to find people to buy my things. So, you know, it can be a chore, it can be a bit tedious, especially if you're of that kind of temperament. You know, artists tend to be fairly individual people, maybe a bit of a loner, self-motivated, like to be working, you know, in an individual way. So it might not come naturally to you, but if you're choosing to market what you make as a career, you've got to do it. Now, it pays to always carry around images of your work. I mean, with these smartphones, that's easy now. You can just have a bunch of photos on there and show them the pose and carry them out before those times. Opportunities to engage with people can happen at any time. You've got to be prepared, so you've got to capitalise on chance encounters. You never know what where they might be. So always have what you do on you, so you can not just talk about it but show people, because often a picture will say a lot more than a whole bunch of words. Get a website, keep a blog, join online groups, use social media, become computer literate. This follows on from what Karina was saying. There are so many opportunities to exhibit work online. Nurture an online following. That takes a little bit of time, but it can be done. The internet is the artist's best-selling tool. Now, having a physical exhibition in a gallery is a wonderful thing. It takes a lot of lead out time, it takes a lot of organising, it's expensive. But it is really nice to have that opportunity. Apart from that, selling online is just wonderful. It makes it possible to make a living. Work hard to find your unique voice. Don't give up at the first value. You need to believe in yourself and just find that niche. Okay, now this is really practical advice. Invest in a good camera and learn how to use it. Take time to learn how to take good photographs of your work, or if you don't have time for that, get someone else close to you that can do it. The power of the internet is that you can finish a piece, photograph it, fill around with it, then expose it, whatever, upload it, have a very large international audience looking at it immediately. This is all new, this has never happened before. I mean, in the 54, 52 years I've been doing this kind of thing, how you past decades, you'd send slides to a magazine in the hope that they'd be published, then wait months until they were, and then so it'd be in a magazine, and then you'd have just a fairly limited audience of the people who happened to buy that magazine. Now your virtual gallery is instantly available to the whole world. Now here's another thing, if you're working on something, take work in progress photos. They're more popular on things like Facebook. They love to see, you know, all these people are sticky feet at you and follow you and stalk you. They like to see how you make things and how you put them together, and quite often you can have sold a piece of work before it's even finished. And the same thing with stop motion YouTube videos. If you're good at that sort of thing, you can do one of those stop motion things. They're very common. Okay, now personally I use Facebook. I have a blog, I have two blogs. I've got a website that's a bit static. I don't do enough of that, but the blog is updated fairly regularly. I have boards on Pinterest. I'm with LinkedIn, which I find a bit useless. I've got a picture trail site, and I've got an Etsy store. Now, what I find most useful of all those things are the blogs, Facebook, and Etsy. Etsy is the online store where I sell work online, and I link Etsy to Facebook and to the blog. So when I upload something onto Etsy that I want to sell, I put a link on Facebook saying, this is available, keep clicks and it's sold. Invest in some photo editing software too. Sometimes you take a really good photo and try and put a blemish on it or something, you have to edit it down to blur a horrible background or something. Be prepared to think of some bread and butter items that are short sellers or easier sellers. So these are things that are perhaps higher volume, lower cost. If you're relying on sales in order to live, you need to have cash flow because the bills can be regular, so you need to have income. Might just be something as simple as cards or prints of your work, small items. I mean, this little brooch here, that's someone's artwork, has been printed on paper and then made into a thingy. Someone gave me that, I don't know where it comes from, probably South America. But, you know, there are all kinds of little things like that you can think of that don't take too much time to do, or outsource the doing of them, that will help cash flow. Consider opening an online store. There are quite a few sites that post online selling about handmade articles. It might take a while to get that going. I know it took me months to start selling on Etsy, but it kind of feeds itself. Once you've sold a few things, it kind of grows and grows and grows, and then you have quite a good income stream. Now, if possible, set aside a dedicated work area for the studio. Separate buildings are ideal, but not always possible. Just do whatever you can make work for you, like a spare room or corner of the living room. Just make sure it's a dedicated space where nothing else but your work happens, and keep it organised for work. For many years, I worked off a dining room table. Then my husband built this enormous studio for both of us to work in. I sold that December last year and moved in February. And I'm now living in Launceston. I have a one bedroom and a three bedroom house set aside as a studio. It's got a little bungalow in the backyard that needs a bit of work on it, and that will be a second studio space for other kinds of work. I think it's important to have space where you can close the door and live through them all. Take up any opportunities that present themselves to teach workshops, to network at symposia, to display at events, you know, when these opportunities present themselves in your own control, I think that's a good thing to do. Okay, now, this will only take half a minute. Lastly, just want to run through what a typical day for me is like when I'm not doing anything unusual. I'm always up at 5 or 6 o'clock. But the bloody cats that wake me up. And I'll have breakfast and deal with emails and Facebook messages, so coffee and toast and do all that while I ease into the day. Between about 8:30 and 12, I usually work on pieces that I have in progress. My sculpting, my sewing, my painting, might be a combination of those things, it just depends on what's on. Between 12 and 1, I have lunch, go for a little walk just to be outside or work in the garden. Now, this is a bit flexible. Between 1 and 2, because I'm also a musician, I need to keep practice up, so I try and fit that in that time. Between 1 and 2, doesn't always happen, just depends. And between 2 and 5, sort of working on pieces again, taking photographs if it's needed, editing photos, uploading, checking emails again. I often have to go to the post office because I would say 90% of my market is in the US. I have to mail stuff out. Quite often that happens, well, a couple of times a week anyway. Between 5 and 7 I'll take a dinner break. Between 7 and 10 I often use this time to do more work, if my old ones can stand it. Especially if I've got something coming up and I need to put in more hours. So it's a fairly long day. I'm usually in bed by 11, but I always dream for an hour or so before I go to sleep. Now, I keep that up for, I don't have weekends, I just keep that up 7 days a week, but because I work like that, if I need to take a day on and do something else, I do. I just, last weekend, I took my friend walk up to the children farm, I just took the day off and off we went, because it's a different day. I can be fairly flexible. I am pretty hard working. But it doesn't seem onerous because what I do is what I am, and it's all just part of my whole life thing. It's not that I can't separate my life from my work, so you know, I'm very happy doing it.
That's a very wonderful story. Wonderful way of ending the presentation. Oh, I have cut you off, but I think that's just
I don't.
I think that was very edifying. Thank you so very much. Let's give our three speakers a clap.